kind of a princess are you?
What kind?
Do you have magic hair?
No.
Magic hands?
No.
Do animals talk to you?
No.
Were you poisoned?
No.
Too Earth? Corporate.
No.
Familiar.
We really need your help.
I'm gonna be real with you. I'm not like the best dragon. Have you ever done like a group project, but there's like that one kid who didn't pitch in as much, but still ended up with the same grade?
Middling.
We're doomed.
But which would be my favorite? Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Disney Reel to Reel, a deep, deep, deep delve into the Disney animated canon. This month, spring is in the air, and we have allergies.
Also because it's like 40 degrees outside.
Yes.
Sucks. I hate Indiana weather.
Yeah, it's the most wonderful time of the year, am I right?
Yeah.
Oh my god. But joining me today once again is Cousin Rayleigh. But we actually have a little announcement to make. She has been upgraded to a real co-host.
I know, isn't it so exciting?
Abso-freaking-lutely.
I'm so honored. Oh my gosh. Oh, I can't believe it. Oh, I didn't even prepare a speech.
I'd like to thank the podcasting community for always believing in me. Yeah. And it's really great because we've been talking about this for roughly a month now, and we don't really have any plans on where to go next.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah. Aside from rankings, of course.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. But, yeah. So... this month, we are talking about essentially the most recent era of Disney animation, which I have chosen to call We Live in a Society. Why do you ask? Well, here's, these films might help answer the question. We have Ralph Breaks the Internet from 2018, Frozen 2 from 2019, Raya and the Last Dragon from 2020, Encanto from 2021, and Strange World from 2022. So I guess to kick things off in response to those movies, my big question to kick us off is, how do you think and feel about the Walt Disney Company at this present moment?
It's kind of hard to like have one opinion about the Walt Disney Company right now. I guess, like, in regards to movies that aren't Disney Pixar, just straight up Disney movies, I'm very middle of the road about them. Either I like them or I despise them with my whole being. Thankfully, only one of these is that last category.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I don't feel particularly strong about, like, most of these movies, you know, like it feels like they're back to playing it really safe.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of like taking risks, and overall most of it just feels very bland.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say that like it feels like, especially towards like the latter half of this, they don't really like advertise these movies very much. So, like,
no,
it's almost like they wanted them to fail. Because, like, it's just, like, straight up, I didn't even hear about Strange World until this month.
Mm-hmm.
Or, like, you know, whenever we were, like, talking about it, like, I never heard of Strange World.
Yeah, I didn't watch it till yesterday.
Yeah, like, even though I have Disney Plus and I have had for a while, I just, like, I never saw any advertising for it. I never watched it. And yeah, I only watched it like yesterday.
Yeah.
But yeah, it just feels like they're playing it safe and like, it's just, I don't feel super strongly about any of them. I mean, they're good, except for one.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, yeah, that's about it.
Yeah. I would say that the Walt Disney Company has reached its centennial, and they could not be playing it any more safe.
Yeah.
Can you believe it? It's been a century of freaking American IPs dominating our media landscape, and now they're like, let's do the thing we did 30 years ago, but make it woke.
Yeah.
Because let's see, the big film entries of this year will be the live-action Little Mermaid and Wish.
I feel like they really dropped the ball with a Little Mermaid. Like, come on. Guy Fieri for Ursula, man. That would have been hilarious.
That was a legit casting decision?
I mean, like...
Or is that Guy speculation?
Guy Fieri literally said he would play Ursula. Like, he said, like, he would be willing to.
Oh, okay. I never heard about that.
Yeah, it's actually very funny. And a lot of people were like, please.
Please.
But I mean, like, besides that joke, it would have been really nice if they had chosen, like, a drag queen to actually play Ursula.
Yes.
Because, again, Ursula's design is based off of a drag queen.
Mm-hmm.
And it would have been great, actually, to, like, have that kind of representation. But no.
No.
They're like, we're kind of woke, but not that woke.
Yeah. We don't want to offend our main source of income. That would be blasphemous. Oh my god, it's been 100 years. Get the fuck over it.
Literally.
Anything else? I would say that in the film department, I am pretty concerned about them. But they seem to be doing pretty well, politically speaking.
Yeah. They're really giving DeSantis a run for his money. It's kind of hilarious.
I know. Walt would be so angry.
Walt, I don't know, man. Walt was something else.
What, have you heard the story about when it was in 1933, there was a staff member who got in trouble with law enforcement because of the perceived act of homosexuality, and Walt kept the guy on staff, quote, saying, quote, give him another chance, we all make mistakes sometimes.
Bruh. Hey, yo, Walt gay?
Anything else? I'm sorry. To all my listeners, I want to keep this as like a time capsule for this year. Disney is, it's, this is going to be a rough one, you guys. Because it's so sad because they're trying to push boundaries largely in technology and in representation.
Yeah.
But also, like, it's really hard to not think about these projects as political statements.
Yeah, I have to agree on that, where it's like, yeah, it's like they're political statements, but like not strong ones.
No.
So it's just like,
Yeah, and it's just like, I've literally been wondering, a lot of people really shit on the Walt Disney era films because of their blatant conservatism and racial stereotyping and...
Yes.
A bunch of rational things to be upset about, but I think part of the reason why it doesn't bother me, like, to the point where I, like, have canceled Walt Disney by this point is because the studio was pretty transparent in a time when conservatism was the norm.
Yeah, and I will say, part of me doesn't like. I mean, I don't fully cancel Disney either, because they are very upfront about, like, right now they are very upfront about how problematic the stuff is in their earlier works. So, like, they don't try to hide it, you know?
Well, some of it.
Some of it. Like, Song of the South, they are 100% hiding. They are not re-releasing that.
You are not going to see a full uncut version of Fantasia either, so.
Yeah, no. But, like, with stuff from, you know, like, 101 Dalmatians or Aristocats, there are, like, some very problematic representations of people. But they acknowledge that, and they do, like, show it just to show that, like, yes, this is problematic. However, it should not be ignored because it's still a problem. Mm-hmm. And that's why I can kind of, you know, I can kind of be like, okay, at least they're acknowledging it.
At the very least.
Yeah.
So, all right, whatever. So, we're going to get into our rankings. Right. Guys, I want this to be really, really fun, but it's going to be... The best way to treat it is going to be like a clown run or something, because I just... It's been a rough time in the world this last week. Okay. So going through my tiers, they are the same as they have always been, which is going from mashiz to respect and appreciate to ait to dud to chicken little.
All right. My rankings, I'm keeping the letters from okay. last time. I'm going to be doing S, A, B, C, D, and F, because... these fists are rated E for everyone.
They're rated for EA Sports.
To the game.
I love it. Okay. So, I guess to kick things off, we will discuss Ralph Breaks the Internet.
Bad.
Yep.
It's a bad movie.
That's a stinker right there.
Yeah. Ralph, you know, Wreck-It Ralph, good movie.
I'm sorry, Wrecking Ralph.
I fixed it, okay?
I know, but alternate universe, Wrecking Ralph.
Wrecking Ralph. You know, Breaking Bad, it's Wrecking Ralph.
My God! Yes, yes. That needs to be like a documentary. Wrecking
so
Ralph.
Funny.
How do we wreck him? How does he wreck himself from within?
How does he wreck it?
How do you live with yourself wrecking it all the time? I'm sorry. Go on.
It's okay. Wreck-It Ralph, good movie. Ralph Breaks the Internet, not good movie.
We can do better. We can do better. Not just thing good, thing bad.
Yeah, I know. It's just... it's so hard to formulate my thoughts. So Ralph Breaks the Internet is an example of people who do not understand the internet trying to make a story about the internet.
Do you mind if I one-up you on that just a moment?
Yeah, go ahead.
I would not only say that this is made by people who don't understand the internet, I would say, honestly, that this is made by people who don't understand Disney movies.
Yeah, I agree. Because, like, it's just so...
Like, let me just pull up the production credits for this movie. I would say that the three big people involved, which are Rich Moore, Phil Johnston, and Pamela Ribbon...
That's a sick last name.
Well, I'm sorry. I don't know how to properly pronounce her last name. I apologize.
It's a sick name.
These three people, along with Josie Trinidad and Jim Reardon, I don't think a lot of these people have had experience with Disney movies recently.
Yeah.
With the exception of the original Wreck-It Ralph.
Yeah, yeah, I can agree to that, because this movie, it doesn't fit in with everything else.
No. It's just an empty, black, gaping hole.
Yeah. Honestly, it's like, I just can't overlook how, like, awfully they depicted the internet. jokes made at, like, certain people's expense is just, like, honestly, this whole movie just kind of gives the ick.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it is very much a gaping black hole. It just ruins everything it touches.
Indeed. I'm reading that story man Jim Reardon, he claimed that Disney did not want to make the movie about the internet, instead focusing on Ralph and Vanellope von Schweetz's relationship, and to treat the internet as the place where the movie takes place, so, you know, like just a basic generic setting. But Josie Trinidad also claimed that the filmmakers didn't want to just give the audience more of that friendship. People had to see that relationship grow. And I don't think this was correct.
Yeah, I don't think they did a good job of that. I think they failed, actually. No, like, not even, like, they didn't even, like, do, like, an okay job. They, or, like, a bad job. They just didn't do it.
No. And,
they
and,
just didn't do
and
the
get
job.
This. Get this. They're claiming that the filmmakers did not want to shy away from covering some of the more unpleasant aspects of the internet, in part fueled by the success of tackling racism indirectly within Zootopia.
You see, the reason Zootopia worked is because it was an allegory. That's why it worked. You can't just straight up depict things in a kid's movie without it being, like, easier to digest. That's why I think Zootopia worked. It's because they, like, obviously it's an obvious one-to-one, but they used an allegory to, like, help it, you know, not be as super in your face. It's obviously in your face, but it's more like a pillow to the face as opposed to a full car crash.
This, you know, movie, I don't think this movie really respects its audience of any age.
It doesn't feel like it respects audience at all. Like, ugh. I hate spoon feedy movies.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a spoon feed movie.
Yeah. And it doesn't help that this came out in an era of a lot of spoon feeding and hand holding movies.
Yeah.
Because, Ralph Breaks the Internet was the second movie that I watched in 2018 in a movie theater.
Yeah, didn't you watch it with our grandma?
Yes. No. I didn't watch that one with her. I watched Ralph Breaks the Internet with my mother and my youngest brother.
Ah, gotcha.
I watched Mary Poppins Returns with my grandma.
Right.
And that was an even worse experience. Quick tangent about that. It's not really a great thing when you have a child in another row of your movie theater get their hand stuck in the armrest thing.
Yeah.
And they have to spend like 10 to 15 minutes getting the child's arm out of the rest thing.
Ugh.
And the child is like easily bothered naturally. And there are other kids in the audience that aren't paying too much attention to what's going on screen. So as a young adult, watching that movie was kind of a nightmare.
I do just want to say, the fact that Ralph Breaks the Internet and Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse came out the same year.
Isn't that wild?
And Into the Spider-Verse is a great movie.
Yes. Yes.
But like, they came out the same year, and yet they have similar target audiences too.
Yeah.
But like, Ralph Breaks the Internet just, it doesn't, yeah, it what's the word I'm looking for? I guess, yeah, it feels like it disrespects the audience. It doesn't allow you to think.
It doesn't allow you to think, but I also don't think these people had a very strong vision either.
Yeah, it feels very much like there's not a cohesive vision. There's not... Yeah. Nobody knew what they were doing with this thing. And it's obvious that they didn't know what they were doing.
No. I guess I only have like two more pressing thoughts before we can move on. So we have to talk about the Disney princesses.
Yes.
Everyone treats this sequence like it was a fucking riot. And to an extent, I think it is a bit cute. But this is like this is the most ultimate case of character assassination.
The scene gave me one chuckle. One little like exhale through the nose reaction, you know? But I think, yeah, it's a little character assassination-y. Except for maybe Merida. Merida kind of came out unscathed.
No, I don't think so. I think they made fun of her Scottish accent.
That's true. But a lot of people make fun of Scottish accents.
I know, but
yeah.
The fact that they have to treat it like, oh, she's the other. She's from Pixar.
Yeah. And I didn't entirely like how she's speaking English, but they treat it like she's speaking another language.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, she is speaking English. You're just not understanding her. And granted, I have had experiences like that with like not understanding people, because I do have like an auditory processing disorder.
Mm-hmm.
But like at the same time, like it felt very patronizing at times.
Yeah.
Very condescending.
This scene is brought to you by BuzzFeed. That's what I have to say.
Oh, I can't stand BuzzFeed.
Every lazy critique of a Disney princess movie that you could possibly imagine is shoved into this 3-minute scene. And yeah. I hate it. I hate it. With a passion.
Kidnapped or enslaved? Shut the fuck up.
And then they try to make Rapunzel be the one girl boss.
It's like, no, they're all girl bosses.
Pamela, what's going on, Pamela?
I just,
I'm sorry, I just need to...
Yeah, I mean, it needs to be talked about, because it is, like, it's, honestly, it almost feels like misogyny.
A little bit. Yes. Do people assume all your problems got solved because a big strong man showed up?
It's misogyny masquerading as wokeness.
Yeah.
You know, and it's so strange.
It really is. And the fact that, like, I've heard people say that the Disney princesses in this scene, they're not meant to be the real Disney princesses. They're supposed to be, like, digital copies made for the Oh My Disney blog.
Yeah.
But not everyone is looking at it that way. So.
Yeah, it's just really. It's confusing. Yeah, I don't like the scene. I mean, of course, like, there's like. I can't even like quote it because I blocked most of it from my mind. But, like, again, there were some lines that, like, gave me a little chuckle. But most of it, I was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Like how I was for most of the movie. I was, like, uncomfortable. I felt like I was wasting my time.
Yeah.
And it sucks because I like the first movie. I like Wreck-It Ralph. But, like, this movie should not have been a Wreck-It Ralph sequel.
No, it shouldn't have been made, period.
Yeah, it should not have been made. Or if it would have been made, I wish it would have stayed in, like, production, like, pre-production a little bit longer. So then they could have actually come out of that with, like, a clear vision, clear story, you know, maybe
well,
think of
it
a few allegories.
Like, maybe not allegories, but I've heard that production began technically as early as 2014, but then they solidified the concept of using the internet in 2016. So the version of the movie that we know was in production for like 2 years.
Not long enough.
Not long enough.
Not long enough, guys. Yeah, like, I don't think, like, the setting itself isn't a problem for me. It's just they use it in the worst way possible.
How do I put this? I know that there are certain things that Disney won't tackle because they're a family movie company, yes.
It's a literal Disney movie.
It is. But I mean, like, there's just something weird when it's, like, the worst thing they could possibly imagine happening on the internet. Are people leaving, like, troll comments under your posts?
Yeah. It's like...
Oh, yeah, the worst part of the internet is when people say rude things about you.
It's like, that is far from being the worst thing.
No. No.
They could have done better with that, because there are far more things worse than, you know, just people leaving mean comments. They could have, like, actually addressed, like, the actual dangers of the internet. Like, sharing your personal information.
Well, there's some things where I'm like, they could get into legal problems with, like, addressing more than one serious issue, probably.
Yeah.
Because then they could probably be in a conflict with, like, Facebook or Instagram or something like that. Maybe. Or Google.
I mean, with Meta, the owners of, like, Facebook and Instagram... They're already in their own legal troubles because of, like, the fact that they keep selling user data.
Yeah.
And stuff. So.
So it's no better that the only way that people can contact this podcast is through Instagram. Or Gmail at disneyreeltoreel@gmail.com.
I can make a Discord.
Oh my God.
I know how to make Discord servers. I can do it.
I've tried working with Discord and... I'm just not active enough.
Yeah.
I've tried it. It's just.
Yeah, I'm most active with Discord. Honestly, I'm hardly on Instagram anymore. Just because, like, I don't like it.
Yeah, I get that.
I'm actually we could set up a Tumblr page. That'd be funny.
Oh my God. Take it back to 2010, baby.
I'm actually back on Tumblr, and it's pretty nice.
Oh my God.
I missed it. It's not nearly as toxic as it used to be because everybody migrated to Twitter.
Yeah. Oh my God. Can our first bit of fan art for the Tumblr be Electra Heart as a Disney princess?
Oh, 100%.
Yes.
Obviously.
I love that. Let's do it. She'll be beautiful. Anyway, I guess my only other comment is, well, I think I know what your answer for this is, but do you think this movie is worse than Chicken Little?
Well, again, you're talking to the person who actually likes Chicken Little.
I know, but, like, come on.
No, this movie is not worse than Chicken Little.
The only reason why it's not going in the bottom tier for me is because there are Disney characters in it. Are they treated well? No. Is it entertaining? Not entirely, no. But
yeah.
does it have Disney shit?
Hmm.
Yes, therefore it goes above Chicken Little.
Yeah, it goes in F tier for me. It sucks. Lol.
Yeah, I put it in the dud category. I know I'm probably going to talk about this movie again at length in a future episode, but God, I'm not looking forward to it.
Yeah. I'd be happy to go on an internet deep dive just to prove this thing wrong.
Yeah. Oh my God. Okay, let's cleanse our skin and move on to Frozen 2.
Frozen 2. How do I start about this movie?
Mm-hmm.
I guess I should say, first and foremost, I did like it.
Mm-hmm.
I like Frozen 2. What else can I say? I liked the concept of, like, the elemental spirits.
Mm-hmm.
That was actually really fun for me. And I also loved, like, the flaming gecko.
Yeah. He's pretty cute.
He was just a cute little guy. And then, like, I also liked the story arc overall with, like, Elsa giving up the throne and finding her own place and Anna coming into power.
So she can be queen of the normies.
Yeah, queen of the normies. But it's okay. She's happy like that.
She is. We'll give it to her.
Yeah, we'll give it to her. She's a girl boss. It's fine. I will say part of the thing that, like, irks me about this movie is it's very similar to the first one, and mm-hmm. that a lot of it is Elsa going and doing something and Anna being like, Elsa, no.
Oh, no, now I have to go find her.
Yeah, or like, I have to go find her. I have to follow her. And it's like, bitch, no, you don't. Anna, calm the fuck down.
Last time I checked, you couldn't run across water.
Yeah.
So are they trying to posit that Elsa is an extension of Jesus?
You know what? I wouldn't put it past him. She basically is Jesus. Just with ice powers instead of reviving.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually, no. She does revive, doesn't she? Actually, wait. She is Jesus.
You heard it here first, people. That'll be the first post on our Tumblr blog. Elsa is Jesus, not headcanon.
Elsa is a Christ allegory.
Yes.
Anyway, my least favorite parts of this movie are still Olaf and Kristoff.
Yep.
Kristoff just seems even more like a fucking nice guy TM in this one.
He's trying so hard.
And it's... gives me the ick. And then Olaf, I find him so annoying. I'm sorry, Olaf girlies, but I just can't.
Strike two against the Sami people. They just can't get it right. Stop telling people that they fuck reindeer. They do not.
But yeah, Frozen 2... I like it overall. Oh, I can't remember the name. Hold on.
The what?
The song that Elsa sings in this one.
Into the Unknown?
Into the Unknown. I like Into the Unknown more than Let It Go.
Mm-hmm.
The vocals in that song, like the back vocals, are ethereal.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Aurora.
Yes, Aurora, thank you so much. You added so much to that song. Honestly, a work of art.
Yes.
Everything about it, I really like that song. Yeah, I mean, I like the movie, except for, like, just a few aspects. You know, just, like, how it's, like, kind of a repeating plot, but still, it still does, like, something different, at least. It's not, like, a one-to-one. And I don't like Kristoff and Olaf.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
All right, before I get started, I'm trying to look up who the conceptual artist for this movie is.
Oh, yes.
Hold on. I'm probably going to have to go through someone's blog posts and try to scroll through some JPEGs or something. These images are shit. Ugh. For the time being, unnamed conceptual artist. I hope they got a big honkin' raise for the work they did on this film.
Yes.
Because I don't think I've seen a Disney movie look so gorgeous since Sleeping Beauty.
I will say this movie has some of the best visuals that I have seen for a while. Honestly, it's on the level of being like an EA game.
Yeah.
You know? Like, It's like, it looks so beautiful. I just want to, like, explore the world.
Yeah. The Enchanted Forest? Sploosh.
Like, please. I would kill to play as Elsa and then just, like, walk around this, like, these beautiful sceneries. It's so beautiful. And I hope they got, like, a chunky paycheck.
Yeah. Yep. I also am really nuts about the effects animation in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
I can really sense their passion and the commitment they put into this. Like, that's the one thing. With all of these movies, except Ralph Breaks the Internet, I can tell that the effects animators are just creaming themselves over, like, how to, like, maneuver
yes.
wind, nature, flora, fauna, fire, water, clouds.
Yeah.
You name it. Like, they're going all out with that shit, and I want to give them the most praise I can give.
Yes.
Because without their contributions, these movies would be a major slog.
Yeah. Like, these movies, besides Ralph Breaks the Internet, just, like, they look absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
And they really should feel very proud of themselves
yes.
for the effects work, all of the particle effects, the lighting. The lighting
yes.
effects are gorgeous.
I think I'm about to give birth to Fernando right now. But yeah. Yeah, that's for real. I'd say that my favorite thing about this movie is Anna's character arc.
Mm-hmm.
Because... Okay, here's the thing. We all know that the OG Frozen was kind of... another jab at, like, Disney tropes and shit like that.
Yes.
But in this movie, it feels like these characters become their own people. And I think that's nowhere more evident than with Anna. Because she learns to embrace change and befriend herself in a way that I don't feel like she had in the first film.
Yeah. I mean, Elsa and Anna's relationship is the backbone of the movie. It is very, very nice to see Anna kind of get away from that dependency that she feels on Elsa.
Mm-hmm.
And to, like you said, like, embrace change and, like, just love herself a little bit more.
Yes. Like, I'm willing to say that Let It Go was the song that we wanted to hear, but Do the Next Right Thing was what we needed to hear.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
That's just such a beautiful moment.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to say I watched this movie for the first time shortly before we went on lockdown. And I don't want to turn this into, like, a sob story, being like, oh my gosh, this is how the pandemic changed me and stuff. Not clickbait. But...
Podcaster breaks down in tears, not clickbait. Real tears.
Real tears you can't see because it's an oral medium. But I think that was the kind of song and that kind of moment that I needed to see before
yeah.
things went to shit.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually watched this in theaters, I think, for the first time. I think I watched this, like, around the time it came out. And
yeah.
I think I watched it in theaters.
Yeah, I saw it on Disney Plus.
Yeah. Watching it in a theater is a ethereal experience. It was
well,
really
then
good.
Then I missed out.
Yeah. But, I mean, I think it's a really good movie. And I solidly like it. It's solid even with the things that I don't like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I can respect it for that.
The things that detract don't take away from the whole experience.
Yeah, they don't kill the movie.
No.
They just, there's just like, it's just like small moments where it's like, I wish this was over sooner. And
mm-hmm.
you know what? I can just skip like 10 seconds ahead and it's done.
Well, you can now. If this movie came out in, like, 1975, then no, you absolutely couldn't.
But I mean, it came out in the current days.
Yes, so. Yes. So we're spoiled, privileged people.
Yes.
Who expect more from their film creators?
Look, the technology's there. We can make good movies, guys. Come on.
We can. But we also need good screenwriters.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah, I'd say that pretty much everything is great except for... Can we talk about that Into the Unknown cover in the credits?
I don't think I watched the credits.
Well, it's not... There's a music video for it. It's not in the credits, but it's covered... It's the Panic at the Disco cover.
Oh. Eh.
Just because it's funny that this is simultaneously a Disney film ranking and a Panic at the Disco album watch. But keep in mind that when he did this cover, he had just come off of doing Kinky Boots on Broadway. He rapped on his seventh studio album? Sixth?
Something around there.
Sixth or seventh studio album, Pray for the Wicked. Which was abysmal.
Yes.
And the music video is just a color copy of his Death of a Bachelor music video. And he's really phoning it in vocally.
Yeah.
And I just wish he could have given a more genuine performance.
Yeah. I'm fine without it.
I know, but there was also another one with Kacey Musgraves. She did All Is Found, and that one was actually pretty nice.
I mean, a lot of the covers that came out around the release of Frozen 2 were all honestly pretty good. Mm-hmm. It was all that was in my YouTube feed for a while, so I listened to a lot of them.
Weezer, bro!
But yeah, I mean, Frozen 2 just has a solid soundtrack.
It does.
It's good.
Oh my God, I'm still trying to look up the concept artist.
Is it still like, I mean, were they just not credited?
They'd have to be, but the best I could look up is probably like in the, you know, the Art of Frozen 2 book that I don't own. So yeah. Like, I hate that they're going to be that shady about it.
Jin Kim?
That sounds like the person that did like the character designs. And stuff. I'm getting Brittany Lee.
Mm.
But I know her stuff is a bit more like geometric.
There's also Victoria Ying.
Maybe it's her.
She was one of the ones for like Frozen 1.
Yeah.
So she could have also been grandfathered into Frozen 2.
Yeah, I think it might have been her. I don't have a solid answer. I apologize to everyone.
Yeah.
This era of Disney animation is just not one that I go to research very much because so much of it is kept real close to the studio. So,
yeah.
But yeah, c'est la vie. All right, then we move on to Raya and the Last Dragon.
Oh, we didn't say our ratings for Frozen
2. Oh, yes. I'm sorry. Where do you put Frozen 2?
I put it in A.
That is where from the top?
That's the second from the top. So okay. It's good. But it's not like, it still has things where it's like, I can't give it a perfect score.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I actually put it in the respect and appreciate tier as well.
Mm.
Probably for the same reasons.
Yeah.
But it's just, at the very least, it's so fucking pretty.
It is, yes.
But, yeah.
Top marks, but not perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, now to Raya and the Last Dragon.
Yes. So I actually watched this for the first time yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Because again, this is one of the movies where I got like zero advertisements. So I had no idea that this thing came out until mm-hmm. like a few months after where people were like, "Oh my gosh, Raya and the Last Dragon." And I'm like, "Raya and the what?"
Ryan, the Last Airbender? What?
I was like, huh? Disney released a movie and I didn't hear about it?
What?
Yeah. But I watched it, and I will say, once again, beautiful effects.
Absolutely.
I think the way that they handled like the glowing stones and everything, that lighting was perfect.
Mm-hmm.
It was. I couldn't like. That's what I focused on most of the time. I was like, this is so pretty.
Yeah. And also the fabric animation.
Yeah, the fabric animation is amazing. Otherwise, it's another movie where there is like, what representation is this?
Southeast Asian.
Okay, yeah. So it takes inspiration from places like Indonesia, Thailand, Vietnam, Cambodia. Yeah. So those areas. It's actually very interesting. I found it hard to like really engage myself with the movie. I don't know if it was just because I was like tired or something. But like it didn't really stand out to me. I don't feel like particularly bad about this movie, but I don't feel like super awesome either. You know?
You're indifferent.
Yeah, I'm pretty indifferent. I don't think it's a bad movie. It's more like it's a movie.
Yeah, it's a thing that exists. It's like a tree.
Yeah, and it's like, I wouldn't watch it again, but I am glad that I watched it.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, the only reason I would watch it again would be because it's so beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not too far ahead of you because I first watched this film last summer. So,
yeah.
It was because I had a friend, well, I still have a lovely friend, a colleague, you might say, who hadn't really seen that many Disney films in a very long time. So I showed her Snow White, Raya, and Encanto.
Mm-hmm.
And, of the three, I think this is the one that she was the most pumped for. But I think she might have had similar criticisms to us. So,
I mean, all of the movies that like Disney has done with like other cultures have like pretty much only revolved around generational trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Which is definitely a problem.
Yeah.
In most families.
And I mean, hey, going all the way back to Snow White.
Yeah. But I mean, it's especially a problem in Asian and Hispanic communities.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of like, okay, but like, can we get something different?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it feels very much just like the same story of just like, you know, healing from generational trauma and then everybody's happy at the end, even though that's not how trauma works.
No.
It's not how PTSD works. And it's just kind of like, eh.
Yeah. I think I'm in the same boat with you. I will probably never watch this movie again, but I am glad that I watched it.
Yeah. Like, I'm probably not going to watch it again, but I am happy that I watched it.
Yeah. I'm trying to think anything else. I think I didn't watch this movie when it came out because of the controversies that were surrounding it.
I didn't hear anything about this movie, so I don't even know. Like,
well, some of them were related to the movie, like the fact that they didn't cast the correct Asian people to play certain characters.
Oh, okay. Yeah, they used different Asian ethnicities.
Yeah.
But not
yeah.
South Asian. Southeast Asian.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And then I remember there were some internet critics that were comparing it to Avatar The Last Airbender, and they got roasted about it on Twitter. So, like, something awful.
Yeah.
To the point where they don't even have, like, professional careers anymore.
Oh, jeez.
I'm so sorry, Lindsay Ellis. Please, please come back. She never will, but
yeah. Okay, I'm gonna put it in C tier just because it just feels like it's such a mid movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's mid, But not in like the bad sense. It's mid because it's mid.
Mm-hmm.
That's just like the only way I can describe it.
Initially, I put it in the respect and appreciate tier behind Frozen 2. But I don't know. Like, I feel like if I put a movie in the respect and appreciate tier, that means I want to watch it again.
Yeah.
So I might want to move it down to Ite.
I mean, that's a fair assessment. I mean, it was all right.
Yeah. It's just like, I know that some people, they can critique a movie and sometimes the consensus might not always be fair. But in this one, I think it's pretty well judged.
Yeah. Because I did come into this movie like completely blind and I still came away just being like, eh.
Yeah. And maybe part of my reason for being underwhelmed by it a little bit is also because of the time in which it was released, which was hella toxic. For the world at large.
Oh yeah, 2021. Yeah.
No, wait, wasn't it a 2020 movie?
No, Ryan the Last Dragon's 2021.
Oh, because I thought that Disney was on a plan of, like, they were going back to releasing, like, one movie a year. But if you say so.
It came out in March of 2021.
That's what it is. Spring releases. Yeah, they don't do very release. Well. Because Home on the Range came out in the spring.
At least it didn't come out in January, because January is when real duds are released.
That's true. That's true.
But I mean, it definitely came out at not a great time.
No, but I think February is a pretty good time for Disney movies.
February is pretty good, but if you release before or like right before or right after February, then yeah. you're not expecting this movie to do well.
No. This is we live in a society era's Home on the Range.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
But I mean, I don't think it's necessarily as bad as Home on the Range. It's just there.
Let's just say that when we reach the end of these eras, I think it would be fun to do a top 10 of all the films that we put in like our top categories and then make a bottom 10 list.
Oh, that would be kind of fun.
Yeah. And we both have to like really argue as to whether like what movie should be like number yeah. one or whatever. But Raya is definitely one that we'll be considering.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think I'm gonna leave it at Ite.
Yeah, I put yeah, C tier for me.
Okay.
Where the north wind